You're listening to Paint the Town podcast with your hosts. LA Street Art Gallery resident artist, Teachr, and founder of LA Street Art Gallery, James Chen of
Paint the Town podcast, episode 84. How you doing, bro?
Whew, man. Still kind of mind blown by Menzo One, dude. That guy is amazing, man. It may just he inspires me, he motivates me. He's got such good energy, you know?
And like the tone of voice like he has is like I've been through a lot of shit and very calm. Like you know, I love like those people are wise, you know, I mean, who have that tone of voice, man. You know what I mean? Like and
he's been there, done that, seen it. And can tell you all about it and help save you some time from going through some bullshit.
Totally, man. Totally. Like I said, just a well of wisdom. And like, dude, I look forward to talking to him again. But today we have another person that I'm interested in finding out a lot about. Because I've been seeing him in the streets since LA Street Art Gallery has started, man, basically. Okay.
Oh, dude, I've seen him since I got started. I have too. I mean, the dude is a stalwart. You know what I mean? Like he's been around forever. He doesn't, you know, blow up the town and do everything, but he just keeps getting up.
And he's known for his Marilyn Monroe, but basically he has a few other things that I'm really looking forward to like talking to him about too. You know what I mean? So basically
I'm very curious to see the check your fee part of his,
I like this new segment that we call like check our feed. You know what I mean? But,
hit the, sound. Oh, he's here. Here we go.
Put on your red shoes and dance.
Welcome, Mr. Romano, to the show.
Oh, you guys are crooked.
No, we're not.
It just
not.
Looks like you're crooked, actually.
Well, we are kind of, but you know.
Oh, no. Oh, okay. Well, then I'm just going to watch you guys sideways.
That's fine.
That's fine. But welcome to the show, man.
let me raise the volume here.
Yeah, we can actually hear you fine. Can you hear us okay?
Oh my gosh, yes I can.
Sweet.
Finally,
isn't that nice?
Working.
That was intense right there.
Well, you know what? When we started doing this podcast, we were actually going to people's studios or having them come to the office in City of Industry where we had all the equipment, or we'd take all the equipment to where they were. And, you know, when you're doing it like that, it's so much easier because you can read off of each other and you know when someone's going to say something, you know when someone's about to say something instead of sitting there watching the screen and going, okay, is he done talking yet? Or I don't want to talk over him because then it'll do that freeze frame thing or whatever. So anyway, thanks so much for joining us today. Where are you? Like roughly in Los Angeles? Are you outside of Los Angeles? Like where do you live? What area?
Outside
roughly?
Of Los Angeles now. Yeah.
You're outside of Los Angeles. That's all we get to know.
Nice. Yeah, like a true street artist keeping it secret. Nice.
Sorta.
We're just telling people
I enjoy
that,
privacy.
Awesome. Awesome. You know, like I said, I was just saying before you came on, man, both of us at the start of LA Street Art Gallery and at the start of Teachr's street art career, man, we've been seeing you get up in the streets forever, man. So to me, honestly, man, it's like kind of an honor to talk to you, bro. Like, seriously, I don't know if anybody really knows too much information about you. And I'm hoping to pull as much out because I know you said, you know, you're a little bit private guy, right? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well, here's the thing.
It's nice to separate a couple things in your life. Feels good to know
definitely.
That you got discipline. You know what I mean?
Compartmentalize. Yeah, definitely. What were you saying, Teach?
I was going to start off with the basics. Where are you originally from?
Orange County-ish. Yeah.
West Covina. Specific. That's good.
You're from West Covina?
Shenanigans. I know.
Oh, hell yeah, dog. SGV, okay. Man.
Hey, so probably until I was like 4, but I do remember sitting in the windowsill. So I have memories from it. So I lived in West Covina, you know what I mean?
For sure. Hell yeah, dude. And then you moved kind of like outside of Los Angeles, as you would say, right?
I've been up to Ventura County, Orange County, LA County. All my life, that's just how it's been. Yeah.
Hell yeah, man. So you're a true Southern California, basically.
It feels good all the time. you're from like Ohio or something?
He's just from Florida.
I'm from Florida. Yes, I'm from a little redneck area. They call it either Lower Alabama, the Redneck Riviera, also known as Destin, Florida. But it's a place to either go or get away from.
So it's a really good spot.
Well, no, you know what? If you want to go fishing, if you want to go deep sea fishing, there's some of the best fishing in the world there. They've got some of the most beautiful beaches in the world, mainly because the sand looks like it's snow white. It looks like if you were a cocaine addict, that you would just stop on the side of the road and get a big honking straw and just want to go up and down the road, because, you know, off the side of the road, you look to the right or to the left, when you're going over the island to go to Destin, and there's white sand on both sides. And so it's so white because of the crystal that comes out of the Mississippi River, the quartz. And so all that quartz, the further down Florida you go, the less white it is, and it's not as reflective. But dude, there used to be people getting sunburns on the undersides of their noses and chins.
It makes sense.
From the sand. Yeah. Just from the sand, because they would put, you know, sunblock all over the top and everything, you know, but they wouldn't get the underside of their chin or the underside of their nose. And I used to work at a restaurant as a busboy, and so the customers would come into the restaurant and they'd be all like, you know, and I'm like, yeah, man. That's the quartz in the sand. It reflects off of just like water, okay? So
it's
anyway.
Intense up there.
From a little hick town, but I escaped. And you know, you guys are lucky. You've been here in Southern California all your fucking lives. You know?
Yeah, but
fuck both of you.
You've been through some really good adversity, man. All that quartz bouncing off of you, you've been through some stuff. You're an alligator right now.
I'm a turtle, and
you've got this thick skin. Good
my
stuff.
My spirit animal is a turtle. I've become a turtle now.
Oh yeah, I saw those. Yeah, that molding stuff. My wife knows how to do that. She just needs to get me to do it already.
Yeah, dude, it's the greatest for your, you know, therapy, like working with stuff with your hands and stuff. You know, it's great. But back to you. When did the idea come up of putting something up in the streets? Like, what did it start with? Did it start with stickers? Did it start with, you know, what did it start with?
You know what it starts with. So it was stickers, and it was previously when I teamed up with a clothing company, and I skateboarded all the freaking time in high school, and it got kind of good. So then, like, I teamed up with this clothing company, and their whole promotion thing was guerrilla
marketing,
sticker marketing.
Yeah.
And they invested in a vinyl cut machine, and it cut their stickers, and it was like a sort of like a cursive style. So, like, you know, the F was missing, you know, like, so the name looked very nice. And
can you say the brand for the audience, or if you remember?
Oh no, yeah, I remember all day. Come on, it's Fourth World.
Fourth World, there you go.
Part of my
all
life.
Right.
Yeah, Fourth World clothing. Oh yeah.
No, a lot of like those brands start, like, for example, Supreme was like a vinyl sticker. You know what I mean? Like,
was it really?
I mean, you know, the box logo to me, I always saw it as like a sticker first, and then it became like, I don't know if that's the case. At least for me, that's how it was. And, you know, obviously Obey and stuff like that, right? You see the sticker and then it became like a, you know, I mean, it was street art, but it did become a clothing brand, right? So, you know, it's pretty common for guerrilla marketing, I guess, you know. But anyways, you said the stickers made you bite the bug, basically. I mean, right?
Oh, yeah. That bug was there because I was out there and putting those stickers up, like, all over exit signs on the freeway overpasses. We would hit every single exit sign. And, you know, it's those vinyl stickers where you peel the back off and it's – you rub it, you got to clean the sign first.
Oh, shit.
And then you got to all the dust off, and then you got to put the sticker on, rub the sticker on, and then peel that sticker off.
Oh, no, dude. Those are
those type of vinyl stickers.
Oh, those are doing it again. We did this before.
No, but the thing is, like, no, I really didn't understand what type of vinyl sticker you're talking about. I thought you're just
Okay, hold on a second. Hold on. That is such a huge pain in the ass, that type. Like, when you're talking about wiping off that sign, like, if it's too cold outside and there's condensation on there, it doesn't matter if you fucking wipe it off, dude. It's still going to condensate and be slippery by the time you put that fucker under to wipe it off again, right?
Yep. Teachr knows. He's the teacher. He knows.
Oh, my God.
Sometimes you wipe it so hard. And then
doesn't matter.
Like, oh, my God, it's not sticking. Oh, my God, we got to go. We got to go.
Oh, my God.
So wait, they paid you to break the fucking law, basically.
That's nerve-wracking. No, that's nerve-wracking.
They paid me with clothing. And
they didn't really even pay.
It was more just experiencing a new friendship kind of deal. And they had clothing, and I had skateboarding to bring to the table. And we kind of just teamed up and did our thing. Yeah, it was a good combo. Yeah, yeah. So that gave me the bug. I understood what it was. Like, I was like, oh, going out, getting out all the time. And then it all went, you know, turned up upside down. And then I went into nothing for a few years. And then I had that bug. Teachr knows that bug.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I mean, you know, I'm for us, like, pretty much, I would say around, like, the same time that Teachr started getting up, that's when you started getting the Marilyn Monroe up, though, right? Or
I remember from when I first started seeing the Marilyn Monroe faces. Was there any particular reason for Marilyn, or was it just like, that's just you love Marilyn Monroe and you wanted her to be up more?
It's not even really sort of a love. It was just it looked nice. I got a postcard. Yeah, it's just how it looks. You know, I go off of a lot of a feeling. So then, like, I had a postcard that, you know, was just, you know, it's a movie. I don't even really know the movie. It's like How to Marry a Millionaire or something. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and she's like this in the photo. But their sunglass company called Sabre, Sabre.
Okay.
Yeah, and they had those red sunglasses, stickers.
Mm.
And it was just one day, you know, I got this birthday present. It was this postcard. And then I saw the sticker, and I saw, like, that's going to fit perfectly on that postcard. And the size fit perfectly on the postcard. And then it just sat there on my wall for a while. You know, and then and then the bug happened, Teachr.
I get it. I understand.
And then I got bit again. Yeah, I got bit again. You take some time off from getting up, and then you get bit again, and you're like, oh, man, I need to get up somehow. And and so I looked at that Marilyn postcard, and I'm like, oh, I'm going to cut that chick out. So I just post her up. It feels good when I look at it. It just just how the sunglasses look on that image, you know? And, so it's getting kind of dark in here, isn't it? I can't really see myself.
You're good. Most people just listen to the audio anyways, so.
Oh, okay. You guys are sideways. Let me take a photo.
Actually, it's funny. We'll have to see how this all works out, because you're sideways right now.
Yeah, you guys are sideways, yeah.
So, no, but obviously on my screen, you're the only one, but me and Teach aren't sideways, bro. So,
yeah. Oh, God, it's like right there.
See, Teach are sideways right there. Oh, man.
I feel you.
This will add to the creativity of the episode, you see? Whoever watches it anyway, because if you're not watching this, then they're going, what the fuck are they talking about?
Oh, yeah. Well, at least I got proof right there then. You guys are
there
sideways.
You go.
Yeah, basically, you know what? We're going to do a segment called
Check Your Feed.
Check Your Feed, dude. All right? Basically, what we do is we're going to bring up your, you know, we're going to make it not sideways for a second. We're going to bring up your feed, basically. All right. You see us? You see the feed? It's coming up right now. One second. We're going to kind of just go from your Instagram, basically, down to the – see the screen right now? Is it sideways?
Yeah, it's sideways, but I can see sideways.
Is it sideways for you too, Teach?
No.
Oh, Teachr's lucky.
It looks okay to me too, man. But dude, man, you've been getting up recently, man. I mean, you know, and it's been a lot of varieties to your original image, man. I think it's so cool because it's like you change up the hair, you change up the sunglasses, man. It's like you also just paint her hand sometimes, and there's a flower coming out of her hand right here.
I like that one.
Yeah. I do too, man, because this is like, it combines, like, it's like an evolution of a style, man. I mean, like I said, man, like, what is it about it that keeps you going back to the streets, man? You know what I mean? Like, you got this wash, rinse, repeat. This is a different one, you know. Do you have any other ones that aren't Marilyn Monroe as much? This one is, you did this one as well, too, right?
So I have a revision of that one. Oh, man, I went, see, Teachr, I mean, so I don't know. I'm pretty picky. I'm really, really picky. So, like, I'll get up really early in the morning to go scope out a spot. Like, I've got a revision of that one you just showed, Help Each Other Out. And, you know, his left hand is up this time. You know, let's protest. And they got masks on this time. And I went to this spot this morning and couldn't get up, you know. So, sometimes, you know, Teachr probably knows. Sometimes it feels, oh, yeah, yeah. So someone threw in a tag inside of that with the arrow going through.
Oh, I didn't even notice that.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
For the audience that's listening, man, basically we're showing two guys riding on a bike. One of them is sitting on the handlebars, and there's an arrow shooting through both of the guy's heart. And there, somebody tagged that extra, actually. And then the guy sitting on the handlebars is carrying a suitcase to Help Each Other Out, basically. And they're both wearing masks. So,
yep. Hey, all day. I mean, don't you guys feel that even more now? I mean, come
absolutely,
on.
Absolutely.
Wow, let's go.
Totally, absolutely. Man. Totally, man. I love that, man, because I think it's cool that you, like, update your pieces, man. You know, I mean, you kind of, like, take one idea and then you take, like, a few different, like, just small minor changes to it, you know I mean? Because it's, like, very signature Mr. Romano, man. Like you know, the Marilyn, man. So it's cool to see all these different, like, evolutions, man. Like, what's your goal with this, man? Like, you know,
no,
I mean,
goal, man, it's a feeling. The Marilyn's not even a goal. It's the feeling. You look at it, like, I remember this the first time I put on a black sign, and it was by itself, it was real big. It just felt good to look at it, and I got so many direct messages saying that, like, you know, this, you made my day so much different by doing that. Like, I drive and I just see this broken down Cocos, and now, like, you brought some life into my drive, and that's all the motivation you need. You're changing people's lives, you know.
So basically, what it comes down to, we sometimes we get to the conversation with the artist where it comes down to what your means are with your artwork, you know, because sometimes you know, some artists are graffiti artists and they have anger and they want to express that in the streets, and so they write things that, you know, express their anger or whatever. And then there's other people that, you know, they want to make money with their artwork. And so they have to, you know, do merchandising and advertising and, you know, hype and this, that, and the other. And then there's some people, you know, possibly like yourself, that just enjoy how they feel when they put things up, and they don't care if they sell anything. They don't care if people like it or not. They just enjoy seeing, and it's like a therapeutic thing. Would you say that's more or less you?
Yeah, it's the, I'm attracted to the art of getting up, you know? I mean,
yeah.
Just like those
graphics. My God, it looks like my cat.
Oh, is it really? Oh, this is Kitty Ruxpin.
Looks like Jake.
No, it looks like Lucille.
Oh, sorry, Lucille.
Okay. Or, you know, back when we had Hendrix before he got eaten. But yeah, black tuxedo cats are they're very inquisitive. They're always checking stuff out and everything, right?
Oh, cool. Curiosity, that's really good. You need it.
So anyway, getting back to what I was saying, so you're basically one of the those street artists that that does this more or less just as a therapeutic thing, that because it makes you feel good.
It makes you feel good. I mean,
yeah, man, I love that answer, dude. Because, like, to be honest, yeah, because I don't think we've had. I mean, obviously, you know, Teach does that too, right? You know what I mean? But, dude, hell yeah, man. I love that answer.
Yeah, but you know what? I sell my stuff as well, though.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
And, but I got to tell you,
But that's not your main, right? That's not your
main message.
That's not my main source of income. No. Although now that we are switching careers with flipping houses, the wife and I are not flipping houses anymore. She's going to go full on into writing and producing and directing. And, we've got a film that we've been trying to get together for the past 5 years, but now it's actually finally going to be, put together and everything. We'll actually
provide us
with some funds. It's not like a big movie or anything like that. But, at the same time, the wife was like, well, look, you sold, some of your work in the past. You used to be a commissioned artist in the past. How about, going ahead and trying to sell some of your work now? And, or at least make more of an effort. So now I have a website that has a store and everything. And, I'm going to be putting more stuff up in there. And actually just did a commission piece today, got delivered, and lady was happy with it. So as time goes by, it's actually helping with, feeding the kids a little bit and paying the rent some now. So, but even if it didn't, and for the longest time, for, almost 10 years now, I've mostly done it. It started as a protest, but then, for a while, it got to where it was just more or less therapy for me, to make me feel better and take my mind off of whatever house we were working on or whatever, trauma we're dealing or crisis we're dealing with. You go out in the streets and just put a piece up and it just looks nice and makes you feel good and makes other people feel good. It's a wonderful thing to just be able to do that and not have to worry about it, because sometimes James and I talk about how, people that got up, started getting up around the same time as you and I did, they had a means of wanting to get into art galleries. And then once they got into the art galleries, you didn't see them in the streets anymore. It's really refreshing to know that there's someone out there who just does it purely because it feels good and makes other people feel good.
Is it really? Is that rare?
It really is.
I don't know anybody really.
Let me tell you something. We've talked
really
to
don't
a lot.
Know anybody.
Yeah, we've talked to a lot of street artists on this episode, and I would say that I'm not like a visual artist or anything, so I feel like I can make more of this commentary, man. I think their intention is to, like, at least promote their own art so they can sell their canvas pieces, man. You know what I mean? I would say a lot of times, even the graffiti writers have, when they've gotten older, transitioned into gallery pieces as they've gotten older if they were completely on the streets. So I just want to say much respect, man, for having that purist mentality, dude, because you know what? That's like why I got into street art. It's like to be able to feel good from this public art, man. And you're one of the guys that's doing it in the most pure way, man. So kudos to that, man. Hell yeah, dude.
Dang, that's
do you ever? Here's a question for you. Do you ever see yourself retiring from doing it?
I've been doing it for a long time. I'm like, it's just part of my life. You know what I mean? That shit's in the car.
Yeah.
I'm going.
Same here, man. I don't ever see myself stopping. You know what I mean? Like, there's always going to be something going on, some current event or whatever. And there's going to be like a box somewhere or an item somewhere that if I just made a certain stencil that would go there, would make the greatest statement about whatever that is. Or, if I just want to make someone feel good in a certain, neighborhood that I'm living or something like that, I want to do something nice. I'll never be able to stop that, until the day I die. I'm going to keep doing some kind of street art, just because it's nice to be able to put something there that no one knows who did it, And for someone, it's actually kind of cool to be there and see the people see it, and wonder, wait a second, that wasn't there yesterday. That must have happened at night.
Yeah, yeah.
Who the fuck did that?
Yeah,
Cool. That's one of those wonderful things.
If
to
it looks
see,
all nice,
right?
it looks like it belongs there. Is kind of how like I think. Kind of. Yeah, that's how I think.
I love it.
Well, with someone like, with the image like Marilyn Monroe, that's a lot of people have different emotions, I'm sure. But she's a beauty. She's like a the image of a beautiful woman. And, you know, when you have something that is beautiful like that and you put it in an alley and around all this ugliness and everything, or in a dumpster or something like that, it's like you're bringing some beauty to all the ugliness, and it blends in with it, yet it stands out. You know what I mean? That's what I always felt about it.
Oh, okay. Yeah. It's cool. That's cool that you said that. We're like-minded, I guess. I just, sometimes I feel extra weird going over the tags. Like, I'll try not to go over tags on those dumpsters.
Oh, God, dude,
It feels weird, but like after I do it, it just looks so nice. So it's like, I hope the taggers understand, kind of thing. That's like,
well, you know what? That's another thing with Marilyn Monroe that I think you'll actually get a little leeway from some of these guys, you know, especially if you don't cover them up, or if you don't, you know, if you just cover part of them or whatever. Like, if they're next to Marilyn Monroe, like, dude, that's pretty fucking cool. You know what I mean? As opposed to some advertisement for some, whatever guy thing that some guy's trying to, you know, market or you know, branding or whatever, like, I don't know, like a Monopoly guy or something like that, or
waiting for it.
You know, we just have fun here every once in a while.
You know, but I wanted to tell the audience that it's not just like, hey, we all know him for the Marilyn Monroe, man. You know what I mean? But it's not just that. One of my other favorite pieces of yours, man, is actually a very similar message to teachers, man, of it's all you need is heart, man. You know what I mean? And that's very similar to one of Teach's pieces. It's all you need is the right kind of love. At least when I kind of like, not the theme, not like the exact same message or image or anything like that. But I can see why you're saying that, like, a lot of your guys' art kind of like spreads the same like positive message, man. You know, I mean, completely different styles, man. But like I said, and to me, like, heart is something like, it can get you through anything, man. You don't need to be the most talented guy, man. But if you have fucking heart, dude, if you have grit, dude, you know, I mean, that'll get you through.
I love that piece, man. That's a beautiful piece.
That'll get you through so much shit, basically, because it's like, you know what? The most talented people don't succeed, man. The fucking people who have the most heart succeed.
Yeah. They just keep on going. They're consistent, man.
Yeah. It's amazing, dude. Some of the most talented people I've seen, they do that 80% thing. You know what I mean? They'll get 80% done, and then they'll just be like, this isn't going exactly the way I wanted to go. Fuck it. I'm done. And it's like,
Ouch.
I know.
Just a little bit further. But, dude, you know what I mean? I've probably been a victim of that myself as well.
I feel attacked right now, man.
West Covina.
I'm not talking about you, James. I'm not talking about you at all.
No, I'm just like, you know, to be honest, it's like, but you know, let's talk about that for a second, because it's kind of interesting to me, because I feel like it just depends on what kind of artist you are, right? Some people are like process artists. The process of the doing the work kind of like is what invigorates them, you know what I mean? Some people, like, they want to attain a certain goal. And, you know, for me, from a music standpoint, it's kind of like, dude, sometimes I've been working on a fucking song for like so long, I'm just like, you know what, I'm just going to finish it today. You know what I mean? It's like not up to 100% my own standard, but I'm just going to finish it and then just kind of so I can move on to the next thing I'm doing and not get stuck on this thing too. And that's kind of what I was referring to in terms of like the 80%, you know what I mean? But I always try to finish my projects though. I may give myself a B minus, you know what I mean? You know what I mean? But like I said, that's what I mean, you know? How you feel about that, Mr. Romano?
Oh, I mean, it's you just have to switch it up. Just keep on going. You got to have so many different projects at once. You just got to stay busy, right? I mean, because if you don't, I mean, your mind can take over sometimes.
Mm.
So, you know, you just have to stay busy, you know.
100%. Keep your habits. What are some other projects you have, man?
Well, I mean, it's a mix of life and work. And expression, right? Like, to me, that's what we're all trying to do, because we have to do that.
Yeah, keep it simple, man. That's the best.
I'll teach you. You have twins, right?
Yeah. I recommend one at a time.
Yeah. Well, I had twins too. I mean, that's what happened to me, you know? And then it changed things in the streets. I couldn't get up so much because life happened.
And, how old are your twins?
They're 7 now.
Oh, wow. Okay.
You guys are leading like parallel lives, man. Like,
are your twins?
And he's getting up at the same time. And then, yeah.
Are your, what do you have? Two boys, two girls, a boy and a girl?
Oh, yeah. Boy and a girl, boy and a girl. Yeah.
Whoa, yeah. Another thing we have in common. Holy shit, man.
Yeah, I remember when the first time I met you. Do you remember the first time we met?
No.
Oh.
Dude, you got a
hat. Yeah, he can't even see your face right now, man. So you know.
I had it.
You're about this big, okay? I can't see.
And we got to turn to the side right now.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I had long hair, and I had a white shirt on with a tie. And you were at that spot where it was like that warehouse like 8 years ago, Teachr.
Okay.
Like, it was thrown by like that guy who wouldn't give everyone's painting back.
Well, let's talk about this. We don't know about this. We don't know about this.
Yeah.
Here's some laundry right now.
Shit.
It was like it was like Red Hot or something was his.
Yeah.
I don't know, man. There was
I know what you're talking about. This is a while ago. This is
a long time ago.
Man, when you have twins, these things get kind of, you know.
Come on, an eye guy, yeah. But anyway, why did I bring that up? I don't remember why.
No, when the first time you guys met. The first time you guys met.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He was spray painting with Thrashbird over there.
Yes, yes.
They were doing something, and they were behind like a chain link fence.
Yeah.
And then the guy who was running the show brought me over to meet you and Thrashbird, and I was like, hey, what's happening? We have twins.
And see, now I know why I don't remember you, because it was so fucking hot there. It was so fucking hot that I think I had taken my shirt off, right?
I didn't see it.
And dude, it was so fucking hot. I barely remember anything from that show. You know what I remember? I remember this fucking idiot who was running that show went and put red dots on everything, like everything, right? And so when I arrived, you know, to set up and do some stuff with Thrashbird, I just took like a quick glance and I saw like a bunch of my pieces had red dots on them. And so I was like, dude, holy shit. Like, this is the shit, man. Like, this is awesome, man. We're fucking, you know, so I got like all my pieces sold over here. I'm gonna sit here and do some live pieces and everything. This is awesome, man. Yeah. And then it wasn't long after that, I remember Jason from Gabba Gallery got there. And, you know, he was like, whoa, dude, you know, it's going pretty well. I'm like, yeah, man, it's fucking awesome. And then he came back by and he's like, Teach, come here a second. And I was like, what? And he's like, I don't know whose idea or whatever this was, but all those red dots mean that they haven't been sold yet. And I was like, that doesn't make any sense. What the fuck are you talking about? That doesn't make any sense. He goes, yeah, that's what's going on. Yeah. So yeah, you haven't sold anything yet. It's those are all pieces that are still available that have the red dot on them. And I was like, and then from that point on, I kind of blanked out. Like my head, I was like, okay. Like if I let that sink in, I'm gonna fucking lose my mind and start tearing shit down. Like I hadn't started meditating yet. I was still very much a road rage dude who had hopped out of his truck 5 times in 2 months, ready to kill somebody. Mm. And so luckily I was able to kind of stay in my mind and be like, you know what? Just do what you're doing here in front of you and all this will work out eventually, okay? And so I'm sure if I met you that night, I was probably like, oh, hi, how you doing? Yeah, nice
yep,
to meet
quick.
You.
Yeah, quick. That's it. Yeah.
So that's now I understand why I don't remember exactly, but it vaguely. Yeah, you got the little. So Yeah. Great. I don't have to go to therapy again or forget all that shit again.
Oh, shit. Sorry. Oh, no.
I'm kidding.
You know what's See, cool?
If we were together, and I'm going to hug it out.
Yeah.
Well, dude, you know, anyways, for the audience that didn't understand it as much, whenever I learned this too. At an art show, when things are sold, usually, that's when you get a little red sticker and you place it on the corner of the art piece canvas. And that's supposed to kind of like secretly just tell the people who know, like, oh, this piece is sold. Don't ask for it, you know, for the art collectors and things like that. I didn't really know about that before, too. So, it's weird. Like, commonly, I hear this being done. Like fake red dots putting on there, so it seems like a lot of things are sold. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, that's. I've heard of that being done. Like if you're first night of your show or whatever, you want to make it look like some pieces are already gone.
Yeah.
That, but dude, that just that exploded to take it my head. That exploded my head so fucking bad that I think it. That took a lot of my. You know, I do transcendental meditation now. And I'm sure there's quite a few times where I was doing my meditation where that experience probably was like, tough to get through. But yeah, thanks for bringing that one up.
Hey, Mr. Romano.
I had to drive back a week later and pick up my pieces. He had them in some garage in Beverly Hills. I mean, it was just a pain in the ass.
Guy, whoever threw it together this show, this guy sounds like a fucking asshole, man. Like,
well, you know what? I think. I mean, he meant well. I know that he meant well. But I think that things got a little bit out of hand, and he tried to pull the shit together and last minute a lot of shit that just he didn't realize until it was too late that a lot of things just weren't going to work out, and then it just kind of went south from there.
Mm. Yeah, like what happened to Stone Malone Gallery? Like that's no longer anymore.
Well, yeah. I don't know. I'm not exactly sure. I think has some kind of entity somewhere. But now, what happened with Stone Malone, as far as what I heard, was he sold a couple of pieces for a lot of money, like crazy money, like in the tens of thousands for like a couple of pieces that a celebrity bought off of him. So he started a gallery down on Melrose. And originally it was just his work because, you know, he thought, you know, shit, I sold this to this guy. You know, I should have a gallery and sell my work and, you know, make sense and everything. And then he realized he wasn't selling anything. And, you know, the prices were, he had priced it based on those two pieces that he sold, which, man, that's something people had to be careful of. And one thing that I learned a lot from when it came to Michael Goodman was at the MRG gallery is pricing your work and how, like, you know, if you just have if you sell something for a crazy amount of money, you can't base your prices on that, you know, because you're shooting yourself in the foot because it's going to be hard to find someone else that passionate about your work unless you put decades and decades and decades of time in and have all kinds of accomplishments and recognitions from big galleries and stuff. And so he started, you know, bringing in other artists. And so that's how the Stone Malone Gallery started getting more artists in there. But, you know, with like anyone that has a gallery will tell you it's not a money-making situation. Unless you are Blum and Poe, you know, down there in Culver City on La Cienega Boulevard across the street from the Lurie Gallery. Mm. You know, these guys sell millions of dollars. You know, millions. Every year. Yeah. Millions of dollars in artwork. But they have a client list. They have a client list of hedge fund people and billionaires. So
let me tell you something.
You got like, money that you have to spend, you know.
You know, like Julian's auctions, right? How they sell like a lot of like crazy price stuff, basically, right? Julian's auctions and things like that, right? It's really interesting because it's like, if you go to like one of their auctions or something like that, I just want to see some of the art sometime, you know what I mean? And you write down your name, they will send you a catalog, right? Automatically. It's like, oh, you're a potential client, you know what I mean? And then like, you know, normally you're just on somebody's mailing list and they just keep on sending you shit forever, basically, right? You know what I mean? But for Julian's auctions, like, nah, these catalogs are like fucking art books, basically. You know what I mean? It's like, it's a nice, like, I'm like, oh, I'm keeping this as my souvenir, you know, I'm ghetto and shit, you know what I mean? But the thing is, like, they know, because it's like, if you don't respond or buy anything within, like, two times, they stop sending you those fucking catalogs, you know what I mean? Because it's like, they're not going to waste their fucking money on you. They know exactly what kind of people they want inside their mailing list, basically, you know what I mean? And if you're not in that people who need to spend money catalog because they have like a hedge fund and they need to fucking show a certain amount of loss, man, you know what I mean, or whatever. I mean, like I said, at the end of the day, these big corporations, hedge funds, they just move around money and make it seem like things are going somewhere. And how do they do that? They buy art sometimes. Like, for example, like one of the companies I used to work with, Axo Nobel, basically, you know, I mean, they have a whole art department. And, you know, they just store it away, you know what I mean? Because they can claim it as, like, something they purchased for their business, man. The art business is insane, man. Like, you know what I mean? It's like, they, you know, if you're talking about, like, the elites, man, like, you know what I mean? That's just a group that's just talking to themselves. You know, they have these crazy auctions. Like, people.
Sounds like drama. Sounds like drama.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
And I'm not in it. It feels good.
That's so smart.
Exactly. And that's why I loved street art. That's why I was saying, Mr. Romano, like, you got into it the same reasons I got into it. It's just a raw culture, man. And, you know, I remember back in the day when Greg was talking about Melrose and Fairfax, man, one of the things that he always, like, stressed about, like, oh, this person's not really a street artist. This person's, you know, a clothing brand.
Go out.
This person's, yeah. You know, I mean, he would, like, one of the things that people, I mean, I enjoyed about his opinions were, like, he was such a purist, man. Like, he wanted to, like, tell people, like, what is, like, true street art. It's not, like, this is not involved with the corporation. This is not involved.
There's a fascist. The street art fascist, for sure.
But you know what? Like I said, I respect
his. I appreciated that about him. You know what I mean? I got a question for you, Mr. Romano. What kind of music do you like? Because James here is a music fella.
I listen to Connecticut musics all day. It's all good. I like to move. I always like to dance. You got to feel good about yourself. And exercises, you know, you got to feel movement and you got to feel good. You got to accept that. And that's what dance music does, right, Shenanigan?
Hell yeah, man. You know what? I knew you were a dance music fan because when I was looking through your feed, bro, you have a Mr. Oizo, man. I'm gonna share the screen right here real quick.
Three times, yeah.
You know this yellow guy, right? Teach you.
Oh, I got Eric.
Yeah, his name is Flat Eric, basically. You know what I mean? And he's by a French DJ. Mr. Oizo, basically, you know, I mean, it's in the 90s. It's kind of like a throwback thing. They used to have a Levi's commercial. You know, fuck it. Let's. I'm gonna look it up and play it. I did a remix of it. Did you check out?
Oh, you did? Oh, play it.
You want me to?
You have yours?
I do have it, man. You want me to play it? Okay, I'll play it, man.
Yeah, man.
Let me see here. Teach, if you don't mind, man, because
dude, please.
Heard it before?
I love all this stuff.
You know what? What's and that? I want to give a shout out to. A fish, actually, because he helped me produce this record, actually. He threw me some notes, man, after my first so shout out to Fish, man. And Mr. Romano, dude, thank you for bringing this up, man. As a, you know, I knew you're a Oizo fan, so you know, like I said, just check this out, man. I hope you guys enjoy it.
Okay, so here we're going.
But dude, no, dude.
Awesome. Right, I love that.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. I love it.
Dude. When did you get into electronic dance music, man?
Yeah.
When did you get into it?
Oh, when? I remember there was a radio station. It was right above Power 106.
Okay.
Way back. So then that I was like, oh, wait a minute. What's this constant beat? Why can't all music have that constant beat? And then, cause you know, that's
that in the 90s or was it in, what era was it in? Like,
It was like a mid to late 90s.
Okay. Power 106 has this show called Power Tools, basically. They used to play like house music at nighttime too. So yeah, there's a lot of cool like EDM, but it's not all the time though. You know what I mean? Like EDM usually, or house music is usually like a nighttime kind of like get the party going kind of thing on the radio. You know what I mean? They don't play it like during the day so much. But now, I mean, it's kind of like changing. You know what I mean? Like electronic dance is like pretty mainstream nowadays. You know what I mean? Did you go to like raves and stuff like that back in the day?
No, I never went to raves. Yeah, I just listened to that station. It was like 106.3 or something weird.
Okay.
And then it went away. And then I just never went. I never went to a rave. And then I went to Coachella.
That's kind of a rave.
That was like sort of like 12 years ago it was like sort of like a rave, like my first rave kind of thing. But
yeah. So which was your first Coachella that you went to, man? I mean, I've been going to Coachella since like, I don't know, fucking forever, man. Like, you know, I mean, I went this year after Daft Punk played, which I regret because I actually went to a C Tiesto the year that, at the LA Sports Arena. But anyways, how many times have you been, man?
Damn, I wish I could grab my phone and Google that, but it's right here.
Tell me and I'll Google it, bro. Tell me and I'll Google it.
It was the Bloody Beetroots, Coachella, maybe about 12 years ago, 14 years ago.
Yeah, so I'm going to look it up right now. Bloody Beetroots played at Coachella 2009, man. So
yeah, they're wearing a red shirt. I was going there for the Bloody Beetroots to go dance. And then I learned about the Safari tent. And then that's just where the dance tent is. It feels good to let go.
Yeah, definitely. Dude, that's awesome, man. I mean, what other music are you into, man? I mean, you skateboard, man. So you must be into like a few different genres, right?
Just everything. Punk all day. Everything all day.
Nice, man. Nice. Hell yeah, dude. I love that, man. Dude, you got to come out when we have our a sticker party, bro. You know what I mean? Because like
a sticker party.
Yeah, man. We would love to get some of those Maryland stickers, man. Like basically what we've been doing.
We're gonna put a bunch of paste all over each other, and then we're gonna get close to each other and stick to each other.
Sure.
Yeah. Huh? Get some Earl Lube, paste. Shout out to Earl. Earl's Lube. So we're going to put that paste all over us and we're going to all really close and just stick.
Are we? Shenanigan, are you down?
Yeah.
Okay, YOLO.
And what we're trying to do, like right before the COVID happened, man, we're having a St. Patrick's Day party. Basically, I felt like, hey, what better party for shenanigans than St. Patrick's Day, right? Basically, so you know what I mean. Like, I wanted to have a sticker meetup where, you know, the people who listen to the show and us and the artists who came on the show, we can come up and we all have like a sticker meetup where we exchange like stickers for whether it's
pins, little merch, whatever.
You know what I mean? But because of COVID, basically, it got all canceled. You know what I mean? So, I mean,
fucking
dude, man.
COVID, man.
It would be awesome
for you to come out, man, and bring some of your Marilyn Monroe stickers, man. I'm sure a lot of people want some of those, man. So, you know what I mean? If you're free when we have this, party, finally, the sticker party, man, I'd love to just invite you to come out, man, and also enjoy some, DJ house music, man. You know what I mean? So it'd be cool. Yeah.
Maybe I can step in there and take those from you.
Do you DJ yourself?
I practice sometimes. Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. There we go. Dude, I wasn't sure. Okay. Like, dude, what's your setup, bro?
I barely have a setup. That's what it is. Yeah.
It's an expensive hobby, man. You know what? Like, to be honest, it's just to get, for the audience to kind of get an idea of how much it costs to be a professional. Okay, be a professional, have the professional setup that they have at the club. The mixer itself is about $800 for a four channel. Okay, and then each individual turntable that you have, you need four of them. Okay, basically. Each one of those is about $2,000 new. Okay. So, I mean, just to, if you want to be, have the professional club setup, I mean, you know, you need $9,000, man. Okay. And then if you, you know what I mean? And then like, that's just if you want to DJ. If you want to make electronic music and produce, now you go into the synthesizer world. And then, you know, the plug-in world, man, where you're not even paying for like physical items anymore. You're paying for like sounds on the internet now. You know what I mean? It's just,
yeah, you tweak them.
So I always say, man, people always ask me, it's like, hey, what can I do to get started in this? I'm like, don't start, man. Like seriously, this is an endless money pit, basically.
Endless money.
You know, do street art. It's like you can become a legend and with like, you know, one marker, man. Like
just all over the place.
Yeah. Exactly. You know, I mean, you can literally, if hey, fame is your
tacky,
goal.
183.
Exactly. Tacky 183. You know, I mean, nothing fancy. Just the name. You know what I mean? But like I said, some people, you know, they do the DJ thing. They're looking for the fame, man. They want to be the guy in the front of the party where everybody wants to, you know, get on the guest list and things like that. I always tell them, I'm like, look, man, that's like, very rare, even for the most popular guys. They don't, you know, like they have lives to deal with. That's not their focus, man. If you want fame, man, get into graffiti and street art, man. Yeah, all you need is a marker, bro.
Yeah. Anyway, plus they're a lot more likely to get a collaboration with street art than you are with music producing, right?
Oh, 100%, man. Dude, well, one of the things like I always say is like about music, it's just like there's always some sort of, I don't know, it's weird because I love that about visual artists, man. There's not as much like ego sometimes. I feel like, hey, we want to do a collab? Yeah, let's paint together, man. That's awesome, man. But it's like for musicians, it's like, okay, if we're going to have a session, man, all of a sudden it becomes like a fucking political thing to, like, set up, dude. You know what I mean? It's like, oh, okay, where are we gonna meet? Who's Pat is, you know, who's in this crew? Are they like okay to work with you? You gotta be cool with this crew and this crew. It's like so much ego going on, man. So, but I think that the younger, you know, whenever you go to younger artists, man, they're trying to change that, man, because like music is just like, you know, the walls are coming down, man. Back in the day, you had to go to a record label to get your shit heard and then recorded. It's like all these kids are just straight up uploading their music right to SoundCloud now, man, and telling the record labels, fuck you, dude. You know, I mean, it doesn't make any sense anymore, to have your life signed away as an artist and get like some money up front, and then if you sell as many records, then basically you don't have to keep on working for us. It's a weird industry, man, like music, you know. And like I said, more and more people are doing it independently, man. I think we're learning from visual artists, man. Like, you know, I mean, you can do it yourself, man. It's like, shit, dude. Mm-hmm. And that's what I love about street art, man. Shit, it's like, hey, you have the freedom to express whatever the fuck you want on the street, man. But to be noticed, like Mr. Romano, you know what I mean? To be iconic, man, it takes years of work, man.
It has a lot to do with placement. You know what I mean? You can have a nice image like Mr. Romano has, but if you don't want to get a good placement with it, it's not as effective.
I like placement. I'm picking that.
Dude, you've got the most excellent placement. Every time I see one of your pieces.
Thank you.
The placement is just absolutely perfect. And it's also very exact, too. A lot of people don't realize that most of your pieces are actually two separate pieces that you line up. And
oh, not that last one in Melrose, though. Oh, man, I messed that one up.
Really?
Yeah, the glasses don't even match right here. They're so off. That was like my worst one. Just recently, that was my worst one. Oh, man.
Which color glasses is it?
Pink, big pinkies. She's like on a corner wall. That cat. Someone posted it. I don't remember the name.
Oh, you didn't.
Permanent art or.
It's like S I O P maybe. S S K. Oh, my phone's right.
Bells.
Yeah. Okay.
It's on your phone.
Yeah, my phone.
Show it to us.
Skip, are you talking about Skip Houston?
It's like Skip-ick or something.
Skip up. Skip. Oh wait. Oh, I know. I think I know what you're talking about.
He'll do mask photos once in a while.
Right. Anyway, yep, I know what you're talking about. So he got a shot of it?
Yeah, and you can see the crookedness. Yeah, it was in my, I threw it in my stories. I didn't want to throw it on my page, man. Yeah, it was mad.
You can find it on his feed, James.
Oh, I found it.
Oh, you did? Did I post it?
I found it on his page. This one, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, is that the one?
It's by Skip Pock, this one? I don't know. I'm just saying.
Oh, yeah. I think if you scroll. Oh, yeah. So the bottom glass, this doesn't. Dude, that was just the worst one.
See, I wanted to pull
dude,
it up.
Dude, what are you fucking talking about? You can't
fucking
even
perfect.
Tell.
If you're far.
Tell.
If you're, nah, they're way off.
Are you kidding me?
I love a perfectionist, man. See, look at that, man.
But look at the placement. That's what I'm talking about, dude. Look at that placement. It is awesome. It's so awesome, dude.
Oh, yeah. Zoom in.
We're doing, if you're just listening to the audio, man, we're looking at a perfect Marilyn Monroe.
Dude, I still do not see what the fuck you're talking about. It looks awesome.
Mr. Romano is talking about where the sunglasses are just like slightly off. I mean, to him, to us, it looks perfect. You know what I mean?
It's so clear and say that when you see it up close.
You know what? I think that's a great way to like leave it, man. That just goes to show you how much we all like nitpick at our own work. Basically, you know what I mean? When other people are like, dude, that's amazing, man. What are you talking about? You know what I mean? So, like I said, we all do it, man. I think it's like, it's so awesome to hear someone like you that does it for the purest reasons, man, that you still care about like these little details, man.
Oh yeah, all day. I wish I didn't. God damn, I feel it inside, man. Jeez, it sucks.
Dude, yeah. I can relate. I can totally relate. You know, sometimes yeah. Walking away from a piece you're working on is the hardest fucking thing in the world. You know what I mean? And then you take a picture, you look at it later and you're like, oh no. How did I not see that when I was standing there?
That's what happened.
It's so blatant in the picture. You drive back by and you're like, fuck.
It's over.
At least I've done
it. It is.
Yeah. So it's the hardest thing walking away sometimes. But, dude, thank you. Thank you so much for hanging out with us today. Once we get the lockdown over with and we're able to go actually visit and be around people again, you know, I'd like to have you on again. And hopefully you can make it out to the meetup. You know, the merch sticker meetup. That's going to be coming, you know, as soon as it's acceptable, you know, and safe and whatever the fuck that means.
Yeah.
We're going to have it. So,
there's a cure
so
now,
much.
Guys. That's what they said. There's a treatment, guys. So hopefully it'll be soon.
Oh, really? Okay, cool. Sounds good.
Absolutely.
All right, guys. Well, so where can we find you, Mr. Romano? I mean, if somebody wants to reach you to do a collaboration or something.
Oh, DM all day through my Instagram, Mr. Romano. No space. Nice. It is what it is, Mr. Romano.
Hell yeah. Awesome. You know where to find me, guys. And to the audience, please leave us a review. Thank you guys for leaving us a review and our patrons. You know, Hair McD, Domo, Tamara, Mike. Tamara. Love you guys. Thank you guys so much. We really appreciate you guys. Check out our Patreon page if you get the chance, audience, and leave us a review again, like I said, and give us a follow at PTTP Show. All right. Thank you so much, guys. Anything
like,
else?
Share, subscribe.
Yeah, tell your friends, all right? Because this is all organic. Thank you so much, guys. To the audience, love you guys. Take care. Peace.
Nice.